Welcome to Hematopoiesis, Part 1. I'm Dr. Catherine Moore, the Histology Wizard. Mature blood cells have a relatively short lifespan, and so they must continuously be replaced with new cells from precursors in the bone marrow. And this process is termed hematopoiesis, or hemopoiesis, from the Greek words hema meaning blood and poien meaning a making. This tutorial will follow hematopoiesis from embryo to adult, give an overview of the stem and progenitor cells of hematopoiesis, and describe the histology of the bone marrow. Histologically, blood is considered to be a specialized connective tissue, since it arises from mesoderm, or undifferentiated mesenchymal cells, those same cells that give rise to adipose tissue, chondroblasts, and osteoblasts. Hematopoietic tissue, or blood, is also considered to be discontinuous, that is, it's produced in one tissue but functions elsewhere. In this case, cells in the adult are born in the bone marrow, but they function throughout the body. Marrow, then, is considered central, while the rest of the body is peripheral, and these terms are important for pathology. For example, a problem that affects blood cell production is considered to be a central problem, while anything that affects the blood cells in other locations of the body, such as destruction of red blood cells in the spleen, is considered a peripheral problem. Production of blood cells can be increased or decreased according to the body's needs, and this is controlled by a large signaling network of cytokines. Now, before we talk about how blood cells are generated, let's take a short foray into embryology. In the middle of the third week of development, the cardiac progenitor cells and blood islands arise from the splanchnic layer of the lateral plate mesoderm. These cells were long thought to be the progenitors of all adult hematopoietic stem cells, but we now know that these cells are in fact a transient population. Their job is to fulfill the oxygen needs of the rapidly developing embryo. But studies in mice have shown that these cells are capable of generating some of the blood cell types, but not the T and B lymphocytes. In other words, they can't be the progenitors because they can't give rise to all adult blood cells. But about day 27, a small cluster of hematopoietic stem cells appears in the dorsal aorta. These cells are hemogenic endothelial cells, and they are capable of generating all the blood cell lineages. So these cells are now considered to be the definitive hematopoietic stem cells and the cells that will sustain lifelong adult hematopoiesis. Now, during the second month of development, first the yolk sac hematopoietic stem cells migrate to and colonize the liver, followed by migration and colonization by cells from that aorta gonad mesonephros region, or that aortic region. At this point, the fetal liver is going to take over the hematopoietic stem cell development with some help from the spleen. The site of hematopoiesis then continues to change over developmental time. So as we just saw, the fetal liver is the major hematopoietic organ for most of the fetal months with minor input from the spleen. And this is part of the reason why those organs, the liver and the spleen, are able to serve in the adult as sites of extramedullary hematopoiesis. By about the third trimester, as skeletal elements are ossifying and bone marrow is developing in the cavities, the marrow of specific bones is going to become the major hematopoietic organ. Now, in children, all spongy bone or trabecular bone produces blood cells, but in adults, production becomes limited to the vertebrae, pelvis, sternum, ribs, and proximal ends of the long bones. These cells will continually leave the marrow and enter the blood. The circulating hematopoietic stem cells will either return to the marrow or they'll migrate to peripheral organs where they exit via lymphatic vessels. Let's move on to discuss the generation of adult blood cells, and we'll start by looking at the different blood cell lineages. So all blood cells arise from a single type of multipotent hematopoietic stem cell in the bone marrow. This cell is often called pluripotent in the literature, but it's now more correctly called multipotent. So we know it can give rise to a number of different cell types, but these cells are actually considered to be within a specific lineage. These cells have very typical stem cell properties, so they're rare and they proliferate slowly. They give rise to two major lineages of progenitor cells that have more restricted potential. Now, unfortunately, hematopoietic lineages can be very complicated to think about. So before we move on to some more complicated diagrams and start layering in the different lineages, let's take more of a 30,000-foot view. If we think of this process as a pyramid, those self-renewing stem cells sit at the top. And as we progress from the top to the bottom of the pyramid, the cells are going to become more differentiated. That is, they're going to gradually assume the morphological characteristics of a mature functional cell type. And at the same time, their developmental potential becomes more and more restricted. Also recall that the stem cells and the immature blood cells are formed in the marrow, so these progenitors are located centrally, while the mature cell types are going to leave the marrow and function throughout the body, so they're peripheral. It's also worth a mention here that although all blood cells are produced in the bone marrow, not all mature there. For example, T cells are produced in the bone marrow, but they later move to the thymus where they mature. Unfortunately, we have to review some terminology, some abbreviations that you'll see on a lot of the lineage trees. That multipotent stem cell is usually called the hematopoietic stem cell, or the HSC. Other progenitors are called CFUs, which stands for colony-forming units, and we'll talk about those in a few minutes. Some of the progenitors derived from the HSC have names that reflect the cell lineages that they'll make, such as the GEEM cell, also called the common myeloid progenitor, or the lymphoid stem cell. Finally, I need to mention signaling again, because the cells are made far away from where they're needed. The body has this elaborate signaling system to alert the marrow to either produce or slow down production and release of different blood cells. And it does this through a series of cytokines and colony-stimulating factors. We'll talk in more detail about erythropoietin and thrombopoietin in a couple of minutes. For the next couple of slides, I've chosen to use an illustration from Junqueira's Basic Histology textbook to discuss the progenitor and precursor cells. You may find that this illustration differs slightly from other books or sources, and that's in part because the field of hematopoiesis is advancing rapidly. So as we fill in our gaps of knowledge, new intermediates and new signaling factors are continuing to be discovered, and their functions continue to be refined. This can be a source of frustration for students trying to study hematopoiesis. However, our basic understanding of hematopoiesis is pretty consistent between the different sources. So here's our more complicated diagram of hematopoiesis. And at the top, we see that self-renewing hematopoietic stem cell. This is going to give rise to two major lineages. Remember, these lineages are more restricted. They're now considered oligopotent, so they make a few different cell types. So first we have that lymphoid line. Here you see the lymphoid stem cell, the common progenitor of B and T lymphocytes. On the left, we can see that GEMM cell, or the common myeloid progenitor, which is going to give rise to the granulocyte, erythrocyte, monocyte, and megakaryocyte lineages. If you follow each lineage vertically, you can see the final mature cell types. For example, the erythrocyte lineage eventually gives rise to the red blood cell. Now, there can be further restrictions in potential. That myeloid stem cell gives rise to a granulocyte monocyte progenitor, which is ultimately going to give rise to neutrophils, basophils, eosinophils, and monocytes, all cells that essentially contain granules. Now, we're going to talk for a few minutes here about hematopoietic growth factors, cytokines, and CSFs, the proteins that are going to promote the differentiation and maturation of different cell lineages. So there are a number of CSFs shown in this diagram, and I've just boxed one example here, this MCSF, or M colony stimulating factor. And this is going to specifically stimulate the production of cells in the monoblast lineage. Cloning of the genes for these factors has greatly advanced the study of blood formation, and many are now used clinically to treat patients with hematopoietic disorders. There are a couple of cytokines you should know about in more detail. First, we have erythropoietin, commonly referred to as EPO, and you've probably heard about this with doping scandals, particularly in biking. This mitogen affects only the erythroid lineage, so it's going to promote cell division and differentiation of the red blood cell lineage. It does this when blood oxygen is low or during cases of anemia, and when fibroblasts of the kidney and the hepatocytes in the liver are going to upregulate production of EPO. EPO is then going to travel via the blood to the bone marrow and increase the production, maturation, and release of red blood cells. And since EPO is made in the kidney, predominantly, many kidney diseases can produce anemia. A second important cytokine is thrombopoietin. This is a major mitogen for the platelet cell lineage, stimulating megakaryocyte production and maturation in the marrow, which is going to ultimately increase the number of platelets in the peripheral blood. Thrombopoietin is also produced in the liver and, to a lesser extent, in the kidney. Now, when studying hematopoiesis, it's very helpful to try and think about the potential effects of changes in these different cytokines on blood cell production. What kinds of situations might call for treatment with specific cytokines? And when might a more general cytokine, for example, one that stimulates all the lineages, be more useful? Try to think about these things as you're studying. So I've just showed you a diagram with a whole lot of progenitors, and I've talked about cytokines. We're going to sidestep for just a minute to look at how those different progenitors and factors were first identified. So here's an example of an early experiment in the hunt for the hematopoietic stem cell. This was an experiment that examined whether there even was a specific cell that could form all blood cells. To test this, a mouse is irradiated, which destroys cell production in the marrow. And as you might guess, this usually ends up killing the mouse. However, if specific bone marrow cells were injected into a healthy mouse, it survived, and new blood cells were found in the circulation. And when they examined the spleen of the mouse, they found nodules on it, and each nodule contained colonies of stem cells that turned out to be clones derived from one cell. Now, this turned out not to be the hematopoietic stem cell, but an intermediate progenitor known as the colony-forming unit of the spleen. So I show this because it's a good example of the type of experiments that are still used, along with culture experiments, to gain further understanding of the signals that control the different lineages. But what exactly is a colony-forming unit? Well, essentially, this is the committed precursor for the major blood cell types. So those multipotent stem cells will give rise to committed precursors that are restricted so that they only give rise to one or two cell types in culture or when injected into irradiated mice. So, for example, those myeloid stem cells eventually give rise to colony-forming units for eosinophils, megakaryocytes, basophils, etc., while that lymphoid stem cell eventually gives rise to CFUs for T cells and B cells. So no doubt hematopoiesis is complicated, but again, it's helpful when studying to try and predict consequences of mutations in specific cells or lineages. For example, what cells would be affected by mutation in the granulocyte macrophage CFU? Try to go backwards and forwards using the lineage tree. What might be the effect of a mutation in the granulocyte monocyte precursor? Conversely, if mutations are found in B and T lymphocytes and platelets, in what stem cell did the mutation have to have occurred? These are the kinds of questions that we'll discuss later in class. So now we've covered some basics about how hematopoiesis occurs, and we'll discuss the specific lineages in a different tutorial. But for now, I'd like to talk about the adult stem cell niche, so the site of production, the bone marrow. Under normal conditions, the bone marrow is going to adjust production of blood cells in response to the body's needs, and it does this relatively quickly. We discussed briefly that bone marrow is found in the canals of long bones and in small cavities of trabecular bone. And there are really two types of marrow based upon gross examination. The red marrow, which is blood-forming marrow, and it's red due to the abundance of blood in hematopoietic stem cells. At birth, all marrow is red, but as we age, most marrow is going to change to yellow. Yellow marrow is inactive. It's fattier, filled with adipocytes, that actually crowd out most hematopoietic stem cells. Interestingly, when the body experiences extreme stresses, such as hypoxia or major blood loss, yellow marrow can actually become active. And in addition, the liver and the spleen can actually serve as sites of extramedullary hematopoiesis when the bone marrow is not functioning due to some kind of pathology. Now, one of the things pathologists do is they examine the cellularity of bone marrow. That is, they look at the percent of cells versus the percent of adipocytes. So here you can see the differences between the two marrows of a 5-year-old versus a 35-year-old. So you can see a definite increase in adipocytes in the older patient. Now, because there are these nice correlations between cellularity and age, changes in cellularity can indicate problems in hematopoiesis or cancers. So here's an example of too many cells in a 45-year-old. So in this case, the cellularity is too high, indicating some kind of a problem. And in this case, it's a leukemia. Normal hematopoiesis is reduced here. Conversely, The cellularity in the second example is nearly zero. So this could indicate a very old person, or it could indicate a severe aplastic anemia. This cartoon illustrates the hematopoietic marrow or niche that contains three basic components: a reticular connective tissue stroma, hematopoietic cords or islands of cells as the parenchyma, and sinusoidal capillaries. So the stroma is a meshwork of specialized cells called adventitial reticular cells and a delicate web of reticular fibers that support those cells. The parenchyma then is that hematopoietic tissue that's going to be located between sinuses, and we call these cords. The marrow is also full of venous sinuses or capillary sinusoids, so these are large fenestrated capillaries that cells can squeeze easily in and out of. So what does this marrow actually look like under the microscope? Here's an H&E stained example of red marrow showing the hematopoietic cords and an example of a capillary sinus. Now note that the cords are organized. For example, cells in the erythrocyte lineage tend to be closer to the sinuses, and you'll see this when we look at samples from bone marrow in the lab. I'll go ahead and stop here, but I'll continue talking about the specific lineages in the bone marrow and how to identify them under the microscope in our next segment. Thanks for stopping by.